Okay, so here we are in chapter one, and we're just getting started. Today, all I want to do for the first day is to go over section 1.1, and that is to talk a little bit about angles. Now, a lot of this should look like review, so let's get through it fairly quickly. You can see here in the textbook, each section starts off with learning objectives. And in this case, we're going to just talk about degree measure and a little bit of geometry. All right, so we start off here with sort of the definition of what an angle is. Angles have an initial side and a terminal side. If you mark out angles, I guess counterclockwise, that would be a positive angle. Marking out angles clockwise would be a negative angle. I'm not going to test you on these versus vocabulary. This is just vocabulary that you need to know to solve some of the problems. Okay, so I'm just going to go through this quickly. All right. Now, angles can be measured in a number of ways. We'll see in this course. We'll be measuring angles with degrees, radians later, and maybe we'll talk about gradients. But let's start with degrees. If you look at one revolution of a circle and break that up into 360 pieces, you get what's called a degree. So 1 degree is 1/360th of a revolution. And you're probably familiar with that. But a degree is kind of big. So you could break up degrees a little further. If you break up 1 degree into 60 pieces, you get what's called a minute. Okay, so 1 minute is 1/60th of a degree. And then a minute can be broken up further into 60 pieces. And so 1/60th of a minute is called a second. So there's 60 seconds in 1 minute and 60 minutes in 1 degree. That's kind of important because we're going to be converting from degrees, minutes, seconds to what's called decimal degrees. Now in this class, most of the problems work in what are called decimal degrees here. So decimal degrees have a degree measure with a decimal point. So 20.5 degrees is the same thing as 20 degrees 30 minutes. So one tick mark there indicates minutes. Now it's much easier, especially when you're using a calculator, to use decimal degrees. And so again, like I said, in this class we'll mainly be using decimal degrees. So if you're given DMS, degrees, minutes, seconds, you're gonna have to be able to convert from that into decimal degrees. Okay, and that's kind of important. That's going to be sort of our first task, converting back and forth from DMS to decimal degrees anyways. To do that, we use what are called conversion factors. So conversion factors are just ratios that you multiply by so that you get your units that you want to sort of cancel. And so in this case, the conversion factor 1 degree to 60 minutes, where 60 minutes is in the denominator on the bottom, you can multiply by that to get rid of minutes. And we're going to do some examples just like that right now. Okay, here we're asked to convert 32.4 degrees to degrees, minutes, seconds. Now the first thing you want to notice is that 32.4 degrees is actually equal to 32 degrees plus some little bit, in this case 0.4 of a degree. Now, the goal is to convert 0.4 of a degree to minutes. To do that, we're going to use a unit analysis. Now, we use unit analysis a lot in trigonometry. So we have 0.4 degrees. We're going to multiply by a conversion factor, a fraction, where we're going to have degrees on the bottom and minutes on the top. Okay, so the degrees would cancel, and we know there's 60 minutes to 1 degree. All right, so multiplying by this conversion factor, we could see here the degrees would cancel, and we would be left with 0.4 times 60 minutes, right? The unit that's left there is minutes. And so when I do that on a calculator, I actually get 24. 0.4 times 60 is 24, and that's 24 minutes. And so now going back to the problem, we have 32 degrees plus 0.4 of a degree, which we just found to be 24 minutes. Now when you're writing DMS, you don't need to put the plus, so we can write this as 32 degrees, 24 minutes. Here we're asked to find the complementary and supplementary angles to 65 degrees. Now to find the complementary angle, we know complementary angles, well, they add up to 90 degrees. So we can say 65 degrees plus the theta that we're looking for, the complementary angle, well, that has to add up to 90 degrees. Then it's just a matter of solving for theta. So in this case, we'll just go ahead and subtract 65, in which case we get theta equals 25 degrees. That's 90 minus 65. Okay, so that's the complementary angle. Now let's look for the supplementary angle. So the supplementary angles, remember, add up to 180. So in this case, we can say 65 degrees plus, say, alpha. That's going to equal 180 degrees. And then, in this case, subtracting 65, we get alpha is equal to 115 degrees. All right, so complementary angles, well, they add up to 90. Supplementary angles, they add up to 180 degrees. And so there's the corresponding complementary and supplementary angles to 65 degrees. Okay, so now I'm still in section 1.1 in the textbook, and we want to talk a little bit now about different types of angles. So we have what are called acute angles, obtuse angles. Here's a picture. Acute angles are between 0 and 90 degrees. Obtuse angles are greater than 90 degrees. We have what's called a right angle. Right angles add up to 90 degrees, and straight angles add up to 180 degrees. Now, I'm not going to test you on the vocabulary here, but you need to know the vocabulary to solve some of the problems. Furthermore, complementary angles you need to know. Complementary angles add up to 90 degrees. Supplementary angles add up to 180 degrees. Those are important vocabulary words to remember. And then in the textbook here, you can look at some examples. But I'm just going to scroll down here to the last objective, which talks about angles in relation to lines or intersecting lines. Okay, so when you have two straight lines that actually intersect, you get what are called vertical angles. So this angle here, theta, is actually equal to angle beta. When you have two straight lines that cross like that, angles that are opposite are called vertical angles. Vertical angles are equal. So theta equals beta. Now, furthermore, you can see we have other vertical angles here. We have alpha and gamma. Those are vertical angles. Those are equal as well. Okay, moving on. Parallel lines. Sometimes you're given parallel lines. In this case, L and M are parallel. And when you have parallel lines, you know they don't cross. The slopes are the same in algebra. But if you draw a line that crosses the parallel lines, that's called a transversal, you get certain angles that are sort of equal. Okay, and so the first ones you want to notice here are alternate interior angles. So here angle 3 and angle 5 are alternate interior angles, and those angles would be actually equal. And then on this illustration, we're looking at alternate exterior angles. So angle 8 would be equal to angle 2. And you can memorize this as sort of common sense. Again, I'm not going to test you on the vocabulary, but you should know what angles are equal in these particular situations. Now, corresponding angles, here angle 2 and angle 6, those would be equal as well. Corresponding angles there. All right. And then from there, you can solve all sorts of problems. There's a bunch of examples here in the textbook. Now, it's also interesting to note, it's also important to note that at the end of each subsection, there's some try this problems. You can actually try that before you move on. Okay, so let's do a couple examples. Okay, we're asked to find alpha and theta where the lines L and M are parallel and given some other information. Okay, so in this particular illustration, I can see that this angle here, 32 degrees, is actually alternate interior angles because we have parallel lines cut by this particular transversal. Okay, Parallel lines cut by a transversal, alternate interior angles are equal. So right away we can see theta is going to be equal to 32 degrees. Okay, so once we know theta is equal to 32 degrees, then we can actually figure out this angle because we know all the angles of a triangle add up to 180 degrees. Let me call that beta. All right, so we can say theta, which is 32 degrees, plus that beta, plus the 68 degrees, all the angles of that triangle here, this is the triangle I'm looking at, all the angles of that triangle add up to 180 degrees. All right, and so now just doing a little bit of algebra, we can say beta plus 100 degrees equals 180 degrees, and then subtracting 100, beta is equal to 80 degrees. Okay, so once I know that's 80 degrees, let me write that in there, then I can see that these angles right here, alpha and that 80 degrees, those are called vertical angles. And we know from geometry, vertical angles are equal. And so at this point, we can say alpha equals 80 degrees, right? Vertical angles. Okay, and so that was the goal, to find theta and alpha. Here we're given two lines that cross and some information, and they want us to find this angle here, theta. Okay, to do that, we'll first look at these angles with the algebra in it. So these angles are actually vertical angles, and we know from geometry, vertical angles are equal. So we can say 2x equals 3x minus 20 degrees. Now with that, we can actually solve for x. In this case, I'll go ahead and subtract 3x on both sides. Just doing a little bit of algebra, we get negative x equals negative 20 degrees. And then dividing both sides by negative 1, I get x equals 20 degrees. Okay, now that's not the angle I'm after, that's actually x. So if I go back over here and I look at this angle, it's supposed to be 2x. So if we know x is 20 degrees, then this angle is actually 40 degrees. All right, now I'm looking at this line right here, and this line creates what's called straight angles. Straight angles add up to 180. So in other words, this 40 degrees plus this angle theta has to add up to 180 degrees. We can write 40 degrees plus theta equals 180 degrees. Okay? And then subtracting 40 degrees on both sides, the goal was to find theta, we found it. So theta is equal to 120 degrees here. Now finally, at the end of each section, you'll find key takeaways. I like this because it's sort of a summary of everything you need to know for this particular section. And so it goes through and gives all the definitions. Keep an eye on that. Scrolling down further, here's where the exercises are. I do assign exercises for each section, and I call them homework notebook problems. So I want you to do the problems in a separate homework notebook, and I will collect the homework notebook on the day of the exam. So you can work out those at your own pace. They don't really have deadlines other than, again, the day of the exam. Okay, so traditional textbook here, textbook questions, but what's different is that the answers aren't listed in the back of the book. They're actually listed at the end of the section. So if you scroll down here at the end of the section to the end of the exercise set, you'll see answers to the exercises. And what's neat about this textbook is that we have answers to all the exercises, not just the odds. So you can do extra if you want, that's perfectly fine. And if you do find an error in the answers, let me know and I'll check it. And if it actually is an error, I'll put that in Canvas for everyone else to know. All right, so that's our first section. I went through it very quickly. And again, this is just a review section, so a little bit of geometry. If you haven't had geometry before, that's okay. You can get through trigonometry here without having a geometry class. So that's why we have these little review sections. And I'll review the geometry facts that you need to know throughout the semester. Okay, so with that, try the assigned problems. I think I assigned 3 problems in this section, so work them out by hand and scan them, convert your image to a PDF, and upload it to Canvas. And that'll be our first assignment. Okay, good luck.